Julia Gillard this week told the mining conference, relax. China will keep growing for decades, buying heaps more of our minerals.
Reports of the mining boom's death have been exaggerated. China is still only 50% through its process of urbanisation and industrialisation.
Dr. John Lee is with Sydney University's Centre for International Security Studies and with the Hudson Institute in Washington, from where he joins me. John, thanks for your time. Is it possible that everything we've assumed about China's miracle boom going on and on is actually wrong?
Well, it's not only possible, I think it's probable. You know, the common assumption is that urbanisation, which you've heard, is driving this building and mining boom in China. Well, urbanisation is happening at about 1 to 1.5% each year, and that's been the case for the last 10 years. Now, if you look at fixed investment in China, which is basically building stuff, that's been rising by 20 to 40% each year for the last 15 years. If you look at the period from 2008 to 2010, building investment basically went up about 70-80% throughout the country. That just doesn't make any economic or commercial sense. So I don't really think we should relax. I think we should be concerned that this mining boom is not so sustainable.
Well, what you're pointing to is this massive building of stuff that maybe they don't even need. I was struck by the fact that by some counts there are some 60 million apartments that are empty that have been built, even entire ghost towns, and that sounds to me like the world's biggest property bubble.
Well, the thing is, China invests and builds things not because they need it economically, but because they need to do so politically to maintain and create jobs in the urban areas in a country. Now, this figure you quoted, that's an estimate that quite a lot of reports have. And if you look at it a little bit further, 67 million, 70 million buildings empty, that will house around 200 million people. So by those numbers, you could stop building any single home for the next 20 years and still house all the people that are moving to the cities in China.
And how that affects us is that our miners have been counting on China eventually needing maybe 50% more steel than they're currently using, which is our iron ore and coal. That doesn't seem to be a very safe bet then, does it?
Not really. If you look at excess capacity of steel in China, it's been rising for the last 5 years. That is, the amount of steel they produce compared to the amount of steel they use has been widening. But it's not just the miners. Now, they've been telling a very optimistic story that isn't warranted by the facts. It's also the government, and the government has a budget based on the continuation of the mining boom almost indefinitely. Now, every credible economist in China doesn't believe that that can happen. And if they're correct, and I suspect they are, I think our budget could be in quite a bit of trouble.
So what would it first do to our economy widely? Is it really a problem for all of us, or is it just a problem for the government in its budget being predicated on a mining boom that will bring in mining taxes and royalties and all that kind of thing?
Well, it depends how it plays out in China, and I think there are two scenarios. If there is a slow burn, that is a gradual slowing down of the Chinese economy, that won't be too bad for Australia. Our businesses will adjust, our dollar will fall, manufacturing hopefully will improve, and our economy will rebalance. If it happens suddenly, and that is possible, it will clearly be disastrous for our economy, and it will also be disastrous for the government budget. But in either scenario, the government budget and the hope for surplus just isn't credible.
And lastly, we all get this idea of the Chinese leadership being super nerds, you know, the kind of super nerds that we tend to, fortunately, sometimes have this racial stereotype of Chinese being super smart. Is that actually legitimate in when you look at this current leadership compared to the genius of the past, like, say, Deng Xiaoping?
Well, our problem is that we don't actually listen enough. If you listen to the speeches of the current premier, Wen Jiabao, when he talks about the economy over the last 3 or 4 years, in almost every speech that he's given, he has bluntly called the Chinese economy unsustainable, unstable, uncoordinated. Now, you can't really get more clear than that. I think it's more a case that we don't really want to listen to information that we don't like, and we tend to talk up the Chinese economy because it's been so good for us. But that's certainly not what the Chinese leaders themselves believe is happening in their own country.
Thank you very much, John Lee.